Hi, I'm Nikki, and welcome to my channel about game development. This is a video in a series dedicated to learning Unity's animation system. In the last video, we learned how to export free characters and animations from an Adobe platform called Mixamo and import them into Unity. Today, we're going to be learning the fundamentals of animating these characters in Unity. By the end of the video, we should have our character animated. We left off the last video having added our downloaded idle, walk, and run FBX files into our Mixamo folder. Let's take a look at the pieces that make up these assets by opening up the idle model. We'll find the meshes, materials, and a rig that make up the model, as well as the animation that we downloaded. If you're wondering why we have two alpha joints and two alpha surfaces, these first two appear to be the skin versions of the meshes, which are a combination of their respective meshes, materials, and the Mixamo rig. And Unity combines both of these to make the complete model. Let's add this model to the scene hierarchy. Placing it here will automatically position it at the world origin, 0 on the X, Y, and Z axis. For personal preference, I'm also going to take this joint material and drag it onto the plane object in the scene view, applying the material. You may initially think that by simply adding the character to the scene, you can press play and the character will start performing the animation that you had downloaded with the character, but it isn't that easy. For the example in this video, we'll be using Unity's built-in animator component and the animator controller asset to get our YBOT to animate. We'll start with the animator component. We'll select the parent YBOT game object so that it is highlighted in the inspector. Next, let's navigate to add component, type in animator, and select it. Let's break down the five properties of this component. Our first property here is the controller property, which is used to assign an animator controller from our assets. Let's create it by right-clicking inside our animations folder of the assets tab, scrolling to create and finding an animator controller. We'll rename it YBOT controller, and then drag this asset into the open slot next to the controller in the animator component properties. Great, so what did that do? Currently, not much. Pressing play again will yield the same results that we had earlier, but I promise we're close. By double-clicking on the YBOT controller, Unity will open a window titled Animator, which consists of two panes, the grid pane on the right and the layers and parameters pane on the left. The grid pane serves as a visual interface for us to create, modify, and connect animation states. But you might be wondering, what is an animation state? To explain this, let's think of our three downloaded animations, idle, walk, and run. Each of these will represent their own animation state in our project. For instance, if a player is not moving, then the character will be in an idle state. And if the player presses forward, the current animation state should logically be switched to the walking state, as the model should begin to move. If they stop, then it should switch back to the idle state. We'll take a deeper exploration of controlling animation states in the next video. For now, it's time to grab the animations from our imported Mixamo assets. Opening up the Mixamo folder in the Assets tab, we'll find our three models. Let's select one of the animations out of an expanded model. Take a look at the inspector, and you'll notice that all the options are grayed out. This is because an animation is a child of the Unity parent model asset. We can actually find the same settings by pressing on the parent model and opening up the Animations tab. Instead, we're going to separate the animation from the model. To do so, we're going to duplicate the animation. This is done by selecting the animation and pressing Command and D or Control and D on Windows. Now when we select our duplicated asset, we can modify its properties in the inspector window. Check the loop property for each animation and move them into the animations folder. Looping the animation will continuously repeat the animation if that's our character's current animation state. Next, we'll refocus our attention on the YBOT controller. With our idle animation selected, we can drag it into the grid layer and we'll immediately see the idle animation state created. Awesome! You'll notice that the entry node is automatically connected to the idle animation state. This is because the idle animation state was automatically set as the default animation state. If we want to switch the default animation state, we right-click on a different animation state and select Set as Default State. This means that the animator controller will automatically use this animation when we enter play mode. And now, if we press play and zoom in on our YBOT character, we'll see him performing the idle animation. To view the walk and the run animation, we just need to switch the default state for our animator controller. We'll end today's project by switching to the running animation and breaking down the rest of the animator component properties. So after the controller, we have properties titled Avatar, Root Motion, and two dropdowns, one for Update Mode and one for Culling Mode. The Open Avatar field is a property that we're going to take a look at in the future when we cover retargeting animations to another character. Root Motion is when we want a character's movement to be animation-based instead of script-based. A quick shout out to Birdmouse Studios for this awesome visual breakdown between the two. I'll link to his video in the description. Let's think of a game like Inside, where the character's movement clearly varies depending on what part of the animation is playing. There's momentum during the middle of the animation, and when the character's switching to the opposite foot, the character movement is at a pause. Then think of a game like Transistor, where the character moves at a steady rate independent from the animation. There's a script running in the background driving this character's game object movement. In the previous video, I explained that we want to check the in-place checkbox. Had we kept the animation that included additional movement, root motion would be able to drive the character. But as I said then, that's not what we're covering at the moment. Moving on to update mode, this is where we can have some fun. Here we have three options: normal, animate physics, and unscale time. Normal will alter the character's animation playback speed based on the current timescale. For example, if we cut the timescale in half, the speed animation will play at half the speed. This makes it easy to create slow motion effects. The animate physics option internally shifts the animator logic to the fix update call. In Unity, fix update is used for all things related to physics. So if our character or animation is intended to interact with rigid body objects, this is likely what we'll use. And lastly, we have unscaled time, which means the animator and the animations run independently from timescale. This is recommended to be used with UI animations, so even if your game is running in a slow motion state, the user interface is still clean and snappy. And the fifth property of the animator component is culling mode, which has three options: always animate, cull update transforms, and cull completely. If you don't know, culling is a performance saving feature built into Unity, which only renders game objects that are in view of the camera. Always animate does exactly what it sounds like. It always performs the animation and animation calculations even when the model is out of the camera view. When cull update transforms is active, Unity continues to calculate the frames in the animation. When the character comes back into view, it's as if the animation never stopped. Whereas cull completely stops the animation when the character is removed from the camera view. When returning to the camera view, the animation resumes playing from where it was before it was disabled. That was so much covered today, but as always, there's still more to learn. In the next video, we're going to take a deeper look at the parameters and layers found in the Animator Controller. We'll learn how we can use them to blend the animations together. As the series continues, we'll learn how to retarget the animations for our own characters, and we'll learn how to control our characters as well. As always, if you learned something new today, please consider pressing that like button and subscribing to the channel. It really helps me out and lets me know that we're headed in the right direction. If you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment below, and I'll be sure to get to it as soon as I can. That's it for today. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.